the Ganpati University. I extend my warm welcome to Dr. Rajen Purohit, Executive Dean, Ganpati University. I extend a warm welcome to Mr. Nehal Seth, who is a member of GCCI Startup Committee and Associate Partner ENY. I extend my welcome to my colleague, Professor Remy Mitra, who is a chairperson, Center for Entrepreneurship Development at Ganpati University, and my colleague, Mr. Akshay Patel, who is administrative officer and an associate member with the Ganpati University Incubation Center. Moving further, I request our honorable Pro-Chancellor and Director General Ganpati University to address the gathering. Please, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me a great opportunity to welcome all of you to this important World of Startup Talk series on how to pitch your idea. We are very much delighted by the acceptance of our invitation of Ms. Priyanka Madnani and Mr. Nehal Seth, and all my colleagues who are joining me from the university on this important webinar. Though we know the reality is that we are locked down in a situation where we are in the four walls of our house, but ideas are not in the four walls. They can always move across borders. And what we have been hearing over the period of time that our country, India, has been the land of ideas and the US has been the land of opportunities. But in today's changed world, India is both the land of ideas as well as land of opportunities. And the ecosystem in last 7-8 years, which has been developed and which has been given right kind of nourishing by the government and other stakeholders involved, what we are seeing is the most passionate time of our history, where we can see that the ideas can be given the right kind of ecosystem and convert them into possible commercial and business opportunities. We have witnessed over the period of time, I have been talking in the at different forums, and people have been asking, can't we have Bill Gates in India? And people said, we already have Bill Gates, but the question was, can we have a Microsoft in India? So that scenario has changed. You can have a Microsoft in India, and you can imagine if you have the right kind of things which are acting as an enabler. And when this thing was told to me, how to pitch the idea, I am basically an academician and running the university from teaching learning perspective. But I am always reminded of a small management story which we came across in the initial years. There was a company which was selling shoes, and they realized that there was an island which has an inhabitation of around 25,000 people. So the owner of the company sent the salesman to find out what kind of market opportunity is there. So he landed on the island, and he came back, wired the report, and said, nobody here wears the shoes. It's a huge market for us. So we can sell like anything. So the owner said, there is something wrong in this man's assessment. So he said, let me send somebody else. So he sent a general manager and said, find out what is the ground reality. And the man goes there and says, wires back, and says, there is no market here. Nobody wears the shoes here. So they are not habituated to wearing shoes. So it's absolutely rubbish. There is no market. So the man realizes that it needs further deep diving. So he sends his marketing guy and says, go and find out what is the ground reality there. So they go there, the marketing guy goes there and wires back. He says, I brought with me few samples. I noticed that people had cuts in their foot. So I traced the leader of the tribe, and I told him that I gave him the sample, and he started wearing it. So he found it comfortable. So it's like that people here are slowly growing in the awareness through the leader that it is it will protect the foot if they start wearing the shoes, and that would help them. And at the same time, because these people don't use any currency, we can trade them for coconuts. So we can supply them shoes for coconuts. And that kind of pitching would give us a market of around 2,000 to 3,000 shoes to start with. And eventually we can think about expanding the market. Now that is how the entire assessment was done, and they could launch the products there. So when a lot of youngsters in the university system, they come up with idea, we do a lot of ideathon, idea marathons, and so many events that happen around the year across faculties. We see students come with a lot of ideas, but we see majority of the ideas which are coming are basically coming from Google. So they simply come across something on Google, or they read something and they try to copy or try to better it. That is what we call as incremental innovation or creativity that they do and they try to implement. In Henderson-Clark model, I am an academician, so I rely too much on the theory part of it. In Henderson-Clark model, they do talk about incremental innovations, and they say when you do slight changes. So it's something like we all have seen Ramayana, the original one, and then there came several versions. But the players remain same. The storyline does not change. But yes, because of the actor, the prominence of a character comes out. But then that doesn't make anything change in the storyline. So those kinds of incremental innovations are happening too much. But at the same time, there are ideas which are radical. Radical in the sense which are out of box, which remove the friction in the business, which try to improve, enhance the business, or give birth to a new business thought. So those kinds of ideas are equally important and are the ones which as a country we should work on. If we really feel that we need to have Google, Microsoft, or such kind of big organizations originating from our country, we need to have radical thinking, and we need to beat the incremental thought process and have to come out with out-of-box thinking. There have been several books which we come across, which we read, and there are several golden rules of success that we come across. But over the years, after reading those books, I realized that there is a need to do some kind of compilation so that we can try to tell the youngsters that how they can keep the golden rules of success with them, at the same time try to be what they are. So I have summarized those golden rules of success, and it says that first thing is aspirations are always possibilities. So you have to keep your aspirations very high. You should never let your aspirations go down. The second thing is imagination is always limitless. So there is no boundaries to imagination. You should not stop imagining. Imagine to better whatever you are thinking and try to make it more perfect over the period of time. Because whatever ideas you work on, probably that would be further perfected with right imagination over the period of time. And the third rule which I came across was, which everybody was talking about, was there is no substitute to hard work. And that's the hardcore reality. There is no substitute to hard work. You have to put your energy, your time, your resources to it. And that's how it works. And that actually brings it more closer to your soul. So there is no substitute to hard work. There is no instant success. So and success never happens by accident. There are a lot of things which people might be talking about, but success never happens by accident. And if in 1% case it might have happened, it doesn't last long. And it's always wrong to wait for opportunities to knock the door. Opportunities always exist. Only thing is you have to see the opportunity, you have to imagine it, and it's there for you. So there is no door, there is no knocking on the door. Opportunities exist and you have to grab it. And you have to be one element which I came across all these literatures was you have to continue to be creative. So you cannot stop being creative. You have to continuously innovate. And the last and the foremost thing which I could tell you is the impression of our country globally that has happened is I in Indian stands for innovation and not imitation. So world over, it has been created that we are very good at frugal innovation. And people thought I in Indian stands for imitation, but we are not about imitation. We are about innovation. And that's how we can differentiate ourselves globally. And this is the best time. China is cornered. All the world has opened up for our Indians. And we have to make the best use of this opportunity. Our Honorable Prime Minister is talking about moving Chinese business, all the investors from China to India. But at the same time, the business and the creative ideas which Chinese were capturing, it is India's time to capture those ideas and to work on it. So with those words, this is the best time. Post-corona, we have been talking about before corona and after corona, BC and AC. Now, after corona, it is a plethora of opportunity which is there. How to pitch, Priyanka ji would be talking about how to pitch your ideas. And at the same time, keep your spirits high, stay home, stay safe, follow government guidelines, and we can collectively fight this pandemic also, and we can help our country become Sone Ki Chidiya again. With those words, thank you very much for a patient here.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring word. I'm sure in such a unique time, the attendees will have a lot of ideas, and with your inspiring word, they will start working on the innovations they have in their brain, and they will start converting their ideas into the prototype. Moving further, we have with us Mr. Nihal Seth. I invite Mr. Nihal Seth to brief the gathering.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh Dave. Hope I'm audible. Yeah. So, I represent the startup committee of the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry, GCCI. We at GCCI, we are delighted to be associated with the GU Incubation Center as an industry partner. Just a brief introduction to GCCI. You know, GCCI was founded in 1949, and today we have approximately 2 lakh members, direct and indirect. We have access to 200 industries, trade associations, and the leading chambers of commerce. The way we function is that GCCI has various committees, like, you know, industry-specific committees like textiles, agro, food, IT, etc. The startup committee is one such committee which we have. The startup committee was established with the objective, you know, to really connect the database which we have, the industries which we have, the network which we have, and to leverage on that and database, and really help the startups ecosystem in the state of Gujarat. So essentially, if I were to put it, it is our members who are our real strength. And we are here to support all the startups from the ideation stage to the execution stage in which we can. In our interaction with startups, you know, we generally find that all you startups, all you guys are, you know, brilliant technocrats, engineers, you know, you're masters of your own products or service or whatever it is. But sometimes what is really lacking is that complete knowledge of the software aspects of the software ecosystem. How to commercialize the idea, which brilliant idea which you guys have. How to take benefits of the Startup India program. How to take benefits of the various schemes. How to really go ahead with the fundraise, opportunities, etc. So I think these are some of the issues which all startup founders, which we have, you know, interacted with, do face. And I think with this vision, we jointly would like to work, and we are working with the GU University to bridge this gap and empower the startups across the entire ecosystem of Gujarat. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nihal bhai, for a quick brief. We have with us our today's keynote speaker, Priyanka Madnani. She has started her career by starting up the startup at a very early stage of her graduation, which is Shahi Andaaz, a portal which is listing a vendor for a marriage. Later, she thought that she should continue some corporate experience, and she joined and founded a call Cheapest and Nearest, which has listed almost
1st of all, thank you so much, Dr. Saurabh, to give such a good introduction, few points to that. So I'm always a good storyteller. And of course, I started my journey when I was my second year of graduation, where that time build something on my own and earn on my own. So this ended up to become a startup, which actually I stepped back into entrepreneurship and starting Cheapest and Nearest. So Cheapest and Nearest, we had more than 500 vendors. We had 2,500 plus vendors, and in all whole Delhi NCR. But there was a time where I made the very first pitch of my life for my startup, and a girl who has always excelled in doing presentations, presenting the company in front of embassies, Germany, France, and making the closing of deals and all. So suddenly there was a time where I got to know that we have to pitch, we have to create something called pitch deck, which we need to send to investors when we want to tell them about a startup. And it was that time for Cheapest and Nearest that I created a pitch deck. It was a presentation. As I told you that I was very good at presentation, I thought that earlier because I was doing a lot of, excelling work, which gave me success in my job. But then there was a time when I'm sending my pitch deck to 10 different investors. And of course, we know that all the 10 investors would not be having that much time that can reply me well, who can reply me well. So, but still, I was lucky enough that there was one out of it who actually took out good time and gave an elaborated feedback in all and each and every slide on my pitch deck. I'm very grateful to that person till date. And it was that time where I got a setback that I have to go back and rework on my pitch, not on a pitch, how to present my pitch, because my presentation is still not up to the mark. That's how I'm getting rejections or the delay of my, further opportunities. That it was that time that I gave a time of 2 to 3 months on making my deck again, whether it's on research work, whether it's on business model, whether it's a unit of economics, whether it's financial modeling, or how much amount should I pitch and what to pitch, like for what I should pitch the amount for to the investors. So it was that time when I got my deck revamped properly, telling about my startup story, and came back in the field and resent to all those investors. And I'm glad that I got good responses from everybody and good opportunities from the same investors who actually didn't reply or refused me. Got recognized with an award, got recognition in top 3,000 startups in India. Opportunity to be a part of incubation at IIT Delhi, being top 30 women entrepreneurs with just that one deck. Right now, why I told you this story, because I want to make you understand that how much important a pitch is, how much important the pitch deck is when we are seeking opportunities, and how it should be, how we should be working on it. So it was then that I decided to keep now drop my startup Cheapest and Nearest, although it was well functioning with the operations and we were generating revenue, early stage revenue although, but I realized that my passion has to be towards, you know, now, you know, helping all the startup founders to be pitch ready and not face rejection when they are pitching to the investors. And then from since then, five years till now, I have been in, you know, good process of helping more and more founders. Even at Easy to Pitch, we have helped more than 350 plus founders pan India and making them pitch ready when they're going to investors. So now coming to back to the topic of the day, that how to pitch in front of the investors, how to be pitch ready when you're pitching to the investors. So first of all, to know how to pitch, you should know what you're pitching, to whom you're pitching, and why you're pitching. If you don't know these three aspects of pitching your startup to anyone, that means you'll always fail some way or the other because you don't know what you're doing, right? So we'll go step by step and knowing about these aspects of pitching. Very first thing is like what you're pitching. Okay, so you have to keep very clear, points in your head, in your mind when you're making a pitch deck. Because what you're pitching is something about your startup. You're presenting your startup in that small pitch or a presentation. The pitch can be a verbal communication. It can be 60-second two-liner pitch. It can be elevator pitch. So these are different types of pitch which I'll be talking about. So there are many types of pitch. So you have to know that how, you know, what you want to pitch in these kind of pitches, right? So what you want to pitch is basic. That is your storyline of the startup. Every time, no matter what pitch it is, you have to present a story. And let me tell you guys, there are many founders. I'm a founder, right? Every founder know that we are so passionate about our business model. We are so passionate about our startup that even if we get hours and hours to speak about us, about a startup, we could give it, you know, we can give it just like that, even not sleeping for nights, right? If we are telling about us, about our company. So, but here you have to be limited. Suppose if I say you have to pitch in 60 seconds. 60 seconds is not similar to those hours. Of course, you can calculate. Now you have to, you know, summarize that hours of story of your startup into two lines, you know, for 60 seconds. So that's how the art of pitching works, where you have to be ready with your pitch in certain circumstances. So what you have to pitch, you have to, you know, keep it, you know, in sync. First of all, the storyline should be very clear in two lines or three lines or even a paragraph. First of all, second thing is that the communication. So talking about what is a pitch, pitch is nothing, just you're communicating your idea to somebody. He can be a mentor, an investor, or a sales, or your customer, potential customer, or anybody around, even in your peer. When you talk about something that you have as a startup, you pitch in one way or another. That means you're sharing about your startup story or startup, what you do there. So the communication has to be very clear and crisp. जो आप समझाने की कोशिश कर रहे हो वो सामने वाले को बहुत क्लियरली और स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड समझ में आना चाहिए. ऐसा नहीं है दैट वी आर स्पेंडिंग आर हेड एंड लॉट ऑफ टाइम इन नोइंग व्हाट यू वांट टू टेल अस, बिकॉज दैट इज समथिंग अ टर्न ऑफ पॉइंट फॉर एवरीबडी हु वांट टू नो अबाउट यू. समझ ही नहीं आएगा फर्स्ट कम्युनिकेशन में, दैट इज you know, not good for your pitch. So the storyline and the communication has to very be clear in what you want to pitch, right? So this was what you want to pitch. Then comes to how you want to pitch, how you're pitching to someone. So of course, when you're pitching to someone, we talk about our human characteristics, right? We have to be very confident. We have to be not fumbling. We have to have very good practice, you know. I'll give you an example. The basic example which tells you how you can practice about your pitch, you know. So I'm sure if all of you or maximum of you are budding entrepreneurs or founders, you must have, you know, gone to startup meetups. Like this is a webinar happening and you're coming to, you know, listen to us like this. You might be going to a lot of startup meetups before this lockdown. There you must have seen that in the networking session, people do tell each other about what they do, because that's how networking session happens. And even there are some meetups where you talk about, you get an opportunity to introduce yourself in front of the audience and you talk about your startup or from where you are. So these kind of opportunities help you always to validate your pitch and help, also helps you to give a practice where a live feedback is coming to you and you can always practice and practice back and come to a normal, like a final pitch after all the feedback. So live feedbacks is very important when you're pitching. So before going to the investors or the mentors or the big people, practice it very well and be confident and be very clear in the communication. So this is how you pitch, right? So these are the two basics of pitching that everybody, again, most of you might be knowing, but I'm helping you to motivate more by telling these again, right? So coming to the very third point, to whom you're pitching. Right. So this is the very important criteria which saves your time and the people's time to whom you're pitching to. Because until and unless you're knowing to whom you're pitching, that is just a waste of time, because that will end nowhere to the communication. Of course, if you know that you are pitching that person to just get a live feedback, this is a complete A point. But now in certain circumstances, you really don't know. You're just going to LinkedIn and you just have searched people written their name with investors or they're investing, right? So this is the major thing that I, the very important thing that I mentioned to everybody, each and every founder, that of course these investors might be useful to you, but you also have to always categorize your process, right? If I know that my startup is from healthcare industry, of course, I will definitely not reach out to the investor who is from maybe aviation industry, maybe from retail industry, maybe from e-commerce industry. But I will definitely reach to the person who can be my potential investor, potential mentor, or someone who is already investing from the healthcare background. And how will I know that? By checking the portfolios, by checking the interest in their LinkedIn, their posts that they are regularly doing. So this saves my time as me, I'm me reaching for the pitching to that person and that person's time in giving you a feedback. Because trust me guys, I do not blame investors for that, because they actually have to deal with hundreds and thousands of startups per week. And I feel I was lucky enough in my early days, 5 or 6 years back, that I got such a person who can review me very well, give me an elaborated feedback, but everybody couldn't, right? So keeping this in a positive note, you should always know to whom you're pitching very well, and this saves time. So these three things that I've covered so far is how to pitch, what to pitch, and to whom to your pitching, right? Okay, so this was all about the basics of pitching. Now we should know that what kind of pitchings generally happen around. So as I begin with telling you two-liner, you know, pitches happening, and as compared to when investors are talking to you hours and hours, like 4 hours, right? So you should know different types of pitching before applying somewhere for your fundraise. So first pitch that I will talk about is the one-liner or two-liner pitch, which is not more than 30 seconds. 30 seconds is actually, I know, very less time to tell about your startup story. But yes, 30 seconds is very important. Let me give you an example, very easy example about my company. Okay, so hi, I am Priyanka Madnani, founder and CEO of Easy to Pitch. We make founders pitch ready. I hardly took 15 seconds. 50 seconds is also much. So here I'm telling you about who I am, what is my company, and what I'm solving here. That is a tagline that my company has. So every startup has a tagline. So why not make such a tagline in your about, like, which can relate your pitch, where a pitch can be done, which can tell what you're doing or what you're solving. So we can always make a pitch with your tagline, which is very relatable and telling the story of your startup, that what you do. So this was the very first thing, which is the one-liner or two-liner pitch you make. And this pitch, I will give you an example, which generally happens when I gave you an example of you got a time where there is startup meetup happening and there are a few set of investors that have came as a speaker or as a panel, right? And there is a networking session, you know that they are rushing. right? They are rushing and they have to maybe go for another set of meeting, and then you are just stopping them and just telling them about yourself in just 30 seconds. And if that 30 seconds is very engaging about you and is actually matching the interest of that investor definitely will end up in giving you a business card and will help you or make you aware that, or ask you to send your pitch deck on that email ID in the business card. So this is very quick, attraction or engagement of the investors, I would say. Another example would be like, if even the investor is not rushing, the mentor is not rushing, even if you're making 2-line pitch, that can grab good attention and the person can ask you to sit with him for next 15 minutes and talk more about your startup, pitch more about your startup. So these kind of opportunities come down the line when you plan yourself, prepare yourself, or practice well with your pitch accordingly, according to the situation. So always go prepared with certain kind of pitches when you're going to certain startup meetup. Okay. So coming to the very second point, second type of pitch is an elevator pitch. So elevator pitch is nothing but, as the name says, you are going in an elevator and you know that the investor or the mentor is also going through the same way, and you can grab the attention in that 60 seconds to 2 minutes. Yeah, so usually 2 minutes is the maximum time an elevator pitching takes, or time period taken in the going in an elevator from floor to floor. So this is kind of an example that I'm giving, but there are many such examples, like just grabbing the attention of the person when they are traveling, then when they are rushing somewhere in the parking slot or anywhere, or even I guess anywhere, I believe. So elevator is just a name given because the time period taken is 60 seconds to 2 minutes generally. So here, when we talk about an elevator pitch, I'll give you an example which I created for my company. So I'll repeat my example. So hi, this is Priyanka Madnani, founder and CEO of Easy to Pitch. We know that founders face rejection when they go to investors, and because they are not good at their pitching, and hence we help startup founders to be pitch ready when they are going for a fundraise, right? So this is how I just spoke about my problems, my solution, and my market and about me in just 60 seconds to 2 minutes. You can always elaborate, but you have to make sure that you are aware of the time constraint, and you have to have everything and anything in that line which is communicable and telling the person about your startup story. So this is kind of an insight for an elevator pitch, which generally happens when you go for competitions like Kickstarts, where you are getting a time period of 2 minutes or 1 minute, and you need to present yourself. You do not have a presentation time. You don't have time to elaborate on your product or your market or anything, but you have these 60 seconds to 1 minute to talk about it, to speak on it, and then grab attention of the person and ask. And of course, gradually and eventually it will go to, after engagement, it will definitely go to a second round where investors ask you more questions or ask you to come and meet and send your pitch deck again, right? So here I made just another point of the type of pitch, that is elevator pitch. So coming quick to the very important type of pitching, which everybody is excited about, I know, because everything, anything we do, we end up doing this third pitch, which is sharing the pitch deck to everybody in our community, in our ecosystem network, where we are telling about a startup. So of course, the pitch deck has the maximum of the importance when you're making a pitch. Why pitch deck is very important right now? So as we know that when we talk about competition, there are lakhs and lakhs of startups who are coming emerging, right? There are of course there are 50,000 plus startups who are registered in Startup India, but are still every day there are thousands or lakhs of startups, even not talk about our country, talk about globally, are coming, are emerging. So when this lockdown period came, there, trust me guys, there were many numerous ideas in lakhs actually came to Startup India. As I'm part of Niti Aayog, I got to know that from the analysis that lakhs of budding entrepreneurs or kids came up with ideas that are actually helping in getting solution for COVID-19, COVID-19 and after lockdown, after COVID-19 situation, post-COVID-19 situation, which can be in the form of agriculture, which can be in the form of technology, which can be in the form of healthcare or even delivery. You know, so these ideas are coming up. So why I'm bringing up this, because you know that you have a great competition when you're presenting your ideas and you cannot be anywhere and everywhere to tell about it. So that's the place where you send your pitch deck, and pitch deck is nothing but 8 to 10 slided presentation where you talk about your problem, you talk about your solution, you talk about your market, you talk about your competitive landscape. So these are the basic template, which I don't want to say because anybody can go on Google and find a template. But here I'm not telling you about the template because, as I said, that is available. I'm here to tell you the better way of sending a pitch deck, better way of making a pitch deck, and how you can, you know, grab attention of the person you're sending the pitch deck to, right? So the basic things that I mentioned, the do's and don'ts when you're making a pitch deck, is that you should always have a storyline. No matter, of course, it's a two-liner pitch, it's a pitch deck. Storyline is very important. You know, 99% of the startups get rejected, but 65 out of those 95% are rejected because they are not able to communicate well. They're not having a good presentation or a good pitch deck, which actually attracts, you know, attracts an investor. And this was a quote by, I want to quote Sanjay Mehta, who is, you know, director and founding member of 100x VCs, which invest in early stage startup, bootstrap startup. So this is said by him only few days back, that nowadays it is sad that the people, the founders who are making good money and good revenue model are getting rejected in front of the people, founders who are creating a good storyline in their pitch deck, are very well representing the story. Because that's how you create and trust in the person who is talking to you, who is listening to you or watching your pitch deck and is visualizing. Because as I said, you are not able to present anywhere and everywhere. So that pitch deck works for you. That passion that you have to show when you want to speak, that pitch deck shows the passion. So here, the storyline is very important. No matter what template you use, the content, the storyline is not the template or the presentation of these problem solution, everything, but a flow in which you're telling about your startup story, beginning from a problem and with the ending up with the amount that you're raising for and why you're raising it for. So the content that you put depicts the storyline. The design that you use depicts the storyline. So now coming to the design, I believe after all my expertise, the 70% of the pitch deck is more of storyline and content, and 30% of your design. Design can be also very well when you have a simple slide, simple plain slide. I wish I could show you a presentation here, but I guess there is not much time I have to tell everything in detail. So there is a plain slide where you are just putting one liner. It's plain white slide and it's also working. It's very simple and very presentable, very professional though. Right. So you have to have that kind of professional design rather than just thinking of a fancy or color or anything. But of course, color does help in the storyline when you put. But that is an additional thing that comes on the way when you create a deck. But 70% of the storyline is the content which you make right from the very scratch. Okay, now the second do's and don'ts, the second don't that I'll tell you out of do's and don'ts will be do not fake your financials. You know, many a times startup founders put future projections without any proper work on their P&L sheet, present and current scenario of their P&L sheet, or they predict it very high, they procrastinate it very good. But you need to understand that there has to be some logical, providing of the data. If you are giving your current financial revenue, please be very true and, you know, what you say, real with your numbers. Do not play with your numbers. It's okay if you have zero revenue or no revenue, or you have downs in your, you know, flow chart of your revenue. Please be straightforward. It's okay. If you have a sustainable model, it will definitely last forever. And definitely the business model can be revamped to improve the revenue. So you have to create that trust, and to create trust, you have to be very real in the startup story. So putting on your numbers is very important in a right way. And projections also very important to put in a right way, because if you're putting any projection without any validation, that can help, that can lead to a rejection, because that, as I told you, the investors doesn't have that much time to give you to validate it first and then ask you for a meeting. You have to get a validated data for your financials. The very thing, third thing is that the market size. Many people do not give a proper research on the market because you have to first know what is TAM, SAM, SOM. If these terms are being weighed for you, that means you have to work on it. TAM is something where you are addressing the whole market. SAM, which you, the market which is your market actually, which you want to achieve out of that global market or a addressable, total addressable market. And like a SOM is something which you can obtain in certain time of period. So as I told you in very brief and crisp manner, you have to have a good search on it and then bring the numbers. If you think you are not doing well in it, you can always outsource or actually ask people in the community who can help you with it and help in the validation, right? So everything and anything comes on the way of pitching. Everything has to be pre-validated before going to the investors or any entity, because validation saves time. Again, I'm saying the rejection, I would say, let me quote you one thing. We always get motivated with certain things that says certain inspirations like Jack Ma, whom we, you know, share a story of motivation that he actually got rejected more than 150 times when he was going for jobs and pitching and everything, right? But then he got successful. I believe that, of course, he's an inspiration. All of the top successful entrepreneurs have gone through a journey where they got rejected. I got rejected, right? In my initial days, I told you I got rejected. But how to act smart now in this busy or fast running, economic pattern, that we as a founder, we have good competition, and rejection is, of course, we are someone who don't want. We get demotivated when we get rejected. I would say that, of course, rejections help in learning, growing, and learning more experiences. But in the end, we are who want to get more rejected or not, right? So what I want to say, the key point is, it's the time when you just stop getting rejected more than 100 times, but get rejected 5 to 10 times and succeed more in pitching. And this can be only done when you're practicing well or getting your stuff pre-validated from the right side of people. It's okay. It's okay to get it validated. And those people who think that sharing of their ideas can create theft or anything like that, let me tell you guys, as an investor and as a representative of the investment people, ideas are the least that we matter, but the execution is what we matter. In your pitch deck, if we see even sometimes the team is very good and the product is not good, the storyline is not there, but team is really nice, no matter they are from good institution or not, but have that passion, that, you know, what you say, that qualities of good leader, we definitely give a chance to them, right? So, but yes, always you have to make the pitch with about your team in a right way in your presentation. So what I want to say is that it's better to reduce the rejection and get the success more, and work on more and more of your practice, right? So these were, okay, talking about back to the pitch deck. Yes, these were the do's, few do's and don'ts which you can take care of when you are pitching to the investors in form of a presentation, and validation I have told you already. And then the very last point that I would like to make, that pitching is something very important and crucial part of anything and everything we do, right? Why? Because that is the only way we can communicate about myself. I made a pitch to you by telling about my company. So I would just want to say that you don't have to lose your confidence if you think that you are not skilled enough to make a presentation or a pitch. But it's always useful and better to take the help from the startup ecosystem and startup community to get it validated or get mentorship. I never had in my time when I started this. That's why I chose to be in this part, to help every founder. So anybody and everybody who are there in the startup ecosystem, try to ask help, seek help up for everybody rather than facing rejection or losing your chance. It's better to take help and then go for a successful pitch. That's all I want to say in the end. At any time, anywhere you want me to help, you can reach me everywhere, in every channel. And if you want to have any question you want to ask, you can always ask in the chat section or anything regarding investment or your pitch. I guess, Saurabh, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you, Priyanka, for a very inspirational speech. You have covered almost all the aspects of pitching the ideas to the right people, right audience, and the investor. And this is going to give them another way forward looking, how to curate their ideas and present to the investor forum. And what are the various way of pitching them, like elevator speech, 30-second speech, a detailed speech, validation speech, will definitely bring values to their ideas presentation. Moving further, so thank you for inspiring all the attendees. We have a couple of questions in the question answer section. Sure. One is where to pitch the idea, how to find out the right person to pitch.
Sure, Saurabh. So this is very important point for all the idea stage founders right now. So at idea, we know that we do not have a product. We just have, you know, brought a problem. We have just brought a solution to it, which is still not processed or not made a prototype out of, or even, you know, tested. So now here is the time that instead of moving directly to the VCs and big fund investors, you should always go to institutional incubations or, you know, the organization that can help you in growth of your idea stage, that is bringing to you to the next stage of MVP. So that can be incubators, that can be accelerators. And I believe there are, if you are a student in a college, there are all the universities having entrepreneurship cells that give you resources. If you need funds, funds definitely are needed in idea stage. When these people are from the organization connected to the right set of investors. And the very important point that I want to make from parents, you know, actually to be done before going to other. The company, right, in kind of payback or something. Do not lose side by side. It's altogether an e-commerce idea. You have to check your resources. You have to check your skills and skill set and talent and what you can do to manage to execute that idea. So just differentiate with these topics, those ideas, and again the knowledge, more the knowledge you have for a particular idea, you can work more. So these are the best criteria which you can choose while deciding what you want to go for.
Mr. Ketan Chhajar has asked how to train yourself for presenting the pitch with the right voice.
Right voice. So I'll tell you one thing. When I started my first speech, I was in my college days and I used to make blunders and mistakes when I was doing a pitching. I was stammering. I still make mistakes when I talk in a conversation like this webinar. So similarly, I would just suggest that practice is the best way that you can do to improve your voice and voice or confidence or any way that any pitch that you're making. Just think that my first pitch 7 years down the line and today that I'm pitching is like lakhs of number of pitching that I've done and days and night I've done. And that's how I'm getting a good practice pitch now. So I'm not suggesting you to do those number of pitches, but of course practice well and you will be definitely confident about it.
The attendee, Mr. Jaydev Desai, is asking, when is the right time to pitch?
Such a good set of questions we are getting today in the panel, in the session. So the right time of pitching, suppose you need to, first you need to understand to whom you're pitching. As I mentioned, if you're pitching to the investors, it's better to find the right time when you are actually ready with a good model. If you don't have any model, but just at idea stage, of course, you can always put an idea stage there in a pitch, but then you have to have a good market research. If you think that you're an idea stage and you want to make the right pitch, right set of people, you have to do that. And if you, suppose I say incubation accelerators, you have an idea, go and pitch. There is no right time. It's just that you have to have a good market research and validated market research. Second thing is that if you're going at MVP stage, you would have to have good model before going for a pitch to the investors, because if you don't have a model, then you are again targeting the wrong people. Then again, if you're at series stage or seed stage, then again you have to be ready with good number of traction. So these are the certain criteria which you have to be ready with. If these are ready, then I guess you're at the right time of pitching. Any time could be right time if you have these.
One of the attendees is asking how to validate the impact of the pitch before investing, pitching to the investor.
So to how to validate, as I told you, we are all group of mentors right now in the ecosystem. We have, you know, more than thousands of mentors who can at least help you to, you know, give you good reviews. What I just said is that at my time, I failed to get reviews from so many, but at least one review I got. So if you have, you know, have decided to get it validated, reach more and more mentors in the ecosystem who have been in the path of fundraising or in certain domain or industry that you have. So once you get reach them and ask them to validate your pitch deck, of course, it will be very helpful for you. And even the investors, many times it's a great thing that people reach to investors to ask for validation first rather than going for directly ask of the funds. Right, so these are the ways that you can use to get it validated. And trust me, if a person is good with the initiative thing of helping you in the startup ecosystem, they'll definitely always be available to you. You can reach me or anybody in the ecosystem whom you find good, resourceful person here for your startup.
Yeah. Another question: how much it is important to present and make a team?
So yes, I'll tell you this story, Saurabh. Thanks for putting this question. So I'll tell you why I failed, maybe. I won't say failed or stopped. Of course, I wanted to start my easy to pitch venture, but then I thought that at cheapest and nearest, I think I am facing a lot of challenges which I can rescue and learn out of it first and then come back with another venture. So cheapest and nearest is the place where I realized that I again, you know, lagged in having a good team, maybe a good co-founder, due to which maybe my process, the current progress and processes are getting hampered. So when we are choosing a team at an early stage, we definitely need a team. We cannot do anything and everything in this world. We are, in the end, we suffer at night of having a lot of burden on us. So we need to have someone who can take half of the work and then help us in the growing of the vision, going of the startup towards a vision you have. So choosing a right co-founder is very important. I face this challenge. I want you to guys be ready with it. Which co-founder will be good if he or she trusts your vision and has the capabilities to, you know, give you his contribution for long, you know, he will be long lasting and is ready to sacrifice his time and not when there is no money also coming inside the startup. So these are the points you should focus when you're choosing a co-founder. And yes, team is very much important. When we are as an investors talking to the startup and we see there is no team, or of course we prefer a team rather than having a solo entrepreneur as well. So it's preferable to have more than one co-founder and more than one founder of the startup. And yes, team is very important to run a startup from the very basic, and it's your core responsibility to how to bring a good founder in the end. You are the decision maker as a founder.
Another thing, one of the attendees, Mr. Vyas, is asking, I have a good idea, but I am worried about stealing off my idea when I pitch to the investor.
Yes, so this is also a very common question that arises in the startup ecosystem from many budding entrepreneurs, and even many of them send this request before disclosing the idea, that if we can sign an NDA first and then disclose the idea. So this is a lot of time happening with the investors, and trust me guys, investor doesn't like it. They don't like it and they say no to it, because as I say, execution matters. But in case that your idea is so unique, so technology oriented, or suppose it's a process I'll give you an example. There were a few days back, there was a agri-tech startup who actually creating an innovation for the farmers. You know, all the innovation is new. You know, the basic implementation of that device, that tool is very new. So, of course, then you can always have a patent first and then share, rather than thinking of if your idea gets stolen. But if you think the idea is already validated, term sustainable and can face any of these situations occurring later on in our life.
One of our attendees is asking what should be included into the market research.
So market research, as I said in the beginning, in the in between of the pitch, telling about your pitch deck. So when you're making a marketing slide, you have to have good data about your total addressable market, that is TAM. Total addressable market is something where you can find that your customer is broadly present. Suppose it's a healthcare, but you have a niche product in that healthcare. You have a category in healthcare. But of course, the whole market industry, whole healthcare industry is your market, right? So that is total addressable market. Then comes your SAM, which is serviceable market, that is already achieved. The market that is already achieved and you are trying to target the untapped percentage of that market share. So that's come when you are marking your obtainable market. So that's how you present your numbers. If you think that you are not ready with these numbers, no problem. Just write your obtainable market. That is enough. Or your TAM. It's fine. We just have to know that is it validated or the market is existing or not. That's it. Nothing more, because the pitch deck is an introduction and has to be limited. No detailed version. Otherwise, you could have sent your detailed business plan in documented form. So there is a difference between a pitch deck and a business plan, which you should always think of when you're making a pitch deck. So least amount of data and a broader aspect can work anytime and every time in market research.
How to decide an option like equity, royalty, or debt?
So anything can be chosen. It's just about your long-term roadmap that you have set, right? If you're very early stage, I guess I'll tell you example of Cashify Nakul, right? Nakul chose to go for a bank loan rather than going for an investment, equity investment. So, and they are successful, right? So it's always your choice which you can make to go for equity or debt. Debt are certainly good, better than equity, because you don't have, you know, overburden of investors always pointing you, poking you, do this, do that, and you have a specific time and interest that you have to return. It's, you are the whole sole decision maker and no other people are hampering you during the process. But if you're going for an equity-based model, no matter, it's okay if you go for equity-based model, but just ensure that any investor you chose, they are adding on very good value to your table. Just not like they are just giving money just like an angel investor and they are just waiting for a return. No, never go for that kind of investor. It would be always good for going for investment, which is adding value to you in all the different terms. It can be partnership, networking, channels, anything and everything they are bringing on your table, which can help you in growth, apart from just putting money in your startup.
How advisable it is to pitch it in team or individual?
Of course, there is one representative of every team. So when you're going in Kickstart live demo days and Kickstart event like these, of course you are there as a team standing, but you have to decide who will be speaking whom, because that has to be many. And there's one point I want to put, I'm very excited to tell this about, because I'll give you one example. I visited a judging event where there was a team which came, there was a team who came to pitch, and there were three founders. And when we came to asking them certain questions and regarding their startup, the answers got clashed. And that is certainly a disappointment, because if you are not prepared in your team what you want to answer something, that is turned no, and that's how we rejected that startup, right? Because there was no teamwork and there was no stable answer for from the team, and a lot of confusion, and that hampers the communication, right? So that is impactful and can lead to rejection. So anybody can answer, no problem. In your founding team, just be clear with your thoughts and just confirm everything from, you know, the whole team, so that clashes never happen later on.
What are the critical elements you have focused on during your startup and you have succeeded?
So the critical elements that I learned from is, first of all, of course, choosing a right team. I learned gradually with a lot of stuff, a lot of challenges that I faced. Team was the first thing. Second thing is that I felt that money is always not important. If we are a startup, we know that fundraise is important for a certain point of time because we want to grow like anything. But in an early stage, if you're running after the funds and not improvising a model, it is never long lasting, right? So just to give you a gist, I mentioned my example that just focus more on your product, more your features and more of your business plan, rather than more focusing on the money coming or the funding that you require. So this is the second key element I would say. The third best thing that I ever had in my life so far in the entrepreneurial journey, that I created a network. In my college days, as I said, I had nothing to take guidance from, right? But as I started to know what is startup ecosystem, I ensured that I am networking with every founder, every member in the startup ecosystem, and I'm leveraging those networks. So if you're a startup and running a startup or starting up with an idea, just ensure that the value of networking and making connection is very big in today's state. So these are the key elements I would like to share from my journey.
Okay. The another question is, what are the critical factors which can impress easily to the investor?
So the basic critical things I would say, when investors see the deck, they actually see the numbers, of course, the financial numbers. If you are very good with your financial numbers and showcasing your product, I'll tell you another example. There was a presentation or deck that came for the investment. No doubt there was not a good model, model or valuation, but the product description was so well that we got engaged and we wanted to know the person more. And we didn't even move to the next slide of finances. So when I talk about impressing any investor, just think that you have to have a engaging content or a good story about your product or your startup. This will always help you to click investors anyway.
At what stage one should look for a multiple investor?
of course, for multiple investor, it would be good if you go for the pre-series stage or beyond seed stage, because then you got to have good amount, which can be more than 2 to 3 crore. And for that, of course, there are very less investors which put the whole money. There are round of investors that the group of investors that come together on the round of table, round table and put money. So it would be beyond seed stage always.
Bootstrapping is not the one of the most popular way of scaling the startup in India. But if even somebody wants to bootstrap the idea, how to pitch to the customer immediately?
So bootstrapping an idea is one perspective, Saurabh, and pitching idea to the sales is another, you know, perspective. You never tell your sales, your customers that we are bootstrapped. We are always telling them that how we are serving them with our service, right? So as I told you, if the model is very sustainable, even bootstrap companies could work. Like, talk about my company. Of course, Steepest and Nearest was at a position where we needed funds to, you know, run out the technical operations, a lot of stuff. But when I come to Easy to Pitch, I'm still bootstrap and successful, right? So there are, it varies model to model, that means. And if you're bootstrap and you think you do not actually require money to sustain, then it's actually perfect. You know, investors will come to you and ask that take our money because they want a good return, right? But if you think that you need money to, you know, expand and pitch to new set of potential customers and to expand to different cities, it's always fine. You just have to show good land, like good scope, and it will definitely work if the model is really good and you've already got good traction. The process is validated. Now, coming to the customers and sales, I believe that I cannot say much on that. I would just say that whatever your model is, just stay truthful to your sales and to your customer part, because if you lose a customer, that means I'll give you an example where I also lost many customers many a time, and we are not able to be reasonable to them or deliver right time that products rightly. But it's okay, it gives you learning and a new challenge altogether to improve yourself. So yeah, my thing would be that just differentiate between what you want to do and how you, like what you want to achieve, and actually what you're thinking is like projecting. You just have to make align things properly in these circumstances. Yeah. I don't know what I'm speaking. I'm like haywire right now because so a lot of things in my mind.
No, but you have rightly pointed out for the right way of scaling the startup idea from the bootstrapping. This should be one of the things. Be truthful and be right to the customers and the
product. Yes, yes.
So Priyanka, thank you for joining today and queries of all our attendees, right? It's very much insightful, and I'm sure all the attendees has learned a lot of things out of this entire session, and they would be most probably ready for their pitch. We have also answered the attendees. If they have a sample pitch ready, we'll make it reachable to you and connect them.
Sure. Anytime, anywhere, they can reach me through you, through Startup Talk, StartupTok. These are my initiative channels on every platform where you can ask me your startup challenge. My LinkedIn, everywhere you can connect me regarding your challenge. I would be happy to help you. Thank you for having me, Saurabh, here on this panel.
We have with us Professor Remy. Professor Remy holding a position of a chairperson at Center for Entrepreneurship at Gurgaon University.
Hi, ma'am.
Invite her for the quick vote of thanks and briefing on the initiative of the Center for Entrepreneurship. Professor Remy.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Saurabh, sir. And it has been extremely informative session, ma'am. Your speech is actually a true reflection on how to pitch. Rather, it's more of a pitch to inspire, educate, and grow for our students. So just to brief about Ganpat University, is actually creating an entire ecosystem for startups and entrepreneurs. Few points which I would like to highlight to the entire audience right now. First, it provides the best incubation facility to you. That is, we have our own in-house student startup and incubation center, which is also nodal center for student startup and innovation policy, Government of Gujarat. Now, what is the use of this kind of platform? It's like your innovative ideas, ambitious ideas are being nurtured here with mentors as well as teachers all along once you have been registered with it. Also, students can also look for initiation and protocols prototype grants because we are already registered in SSIP. Second point, that is Ganpat University has private equity firm, that is Ganpat Biznovation Private Limited. Here, and this is where students can actually look for venture funds. Third, Ganpat University provides you best environment to build team. That was what we were actually discussing before also. Why? Because around the year, students are basically exposed to a number of idea hackathons, smart hackathons, POC competitions. There are TED series, there are expert talk series. There are boot camps, accelerated training programs, exclusive workshops are being carried out throughout the year on, if we talk about business opportunity mapping, if we talk about design thinking through creativity, innovation, then there are digital marketing workshops as well. So these are being regularly conducted. So this provides you an entire platform where we call upon people from industry, from government, from academia to you. And fourth point, which I want to highlight is with an exclusive focus on startup and entrepreneurs, especially for family business people, for young startup founders, for new entrepreneurs, Ganpat University offers an exclusive MBA course, which is a postgraduate two-year course focusing on startup and entrepreneurship. Through this period, you will actually be facing milestone-based learnings, and this course has a unique learning by doing approach. And it has got subjects which involves business opportunity mapping, design thinking, family. Someone talked about family businesses. Someone talked about finance, how to make financial statements. Someone talked about risk assessments, as well as enterprise scalability, as well as diversification, and a lot more. To know more about the course of MBA Startup and Entrepreneurship, you can visit the Ganpat University website, and you can even contact me. And in the concluding segment, I would like to extend my heartiest vote of thanks to Ms. Priyanka Madnani ma'am, founder and CEO, Easy to Pitch. It's an extreme delight to have you in today's talk series. And we would also like to thank Mr. Nehal Sheth, Startup Committee, GCCI. Thank you, sir, for sparing your time with us. We thank Dr. Mahendra Sharma, Pro-Chancellor, Director General. With your vision, the Startup Talk series comes up with new episodes again and again and engaging the entire ecosystem. Dr. Rajan Purohit, Executive Dean, for your constant support and guidance to us, sir. The team behind Ganpat University, the world of Startup Talk series. Dr. Saurabh Dave, Head Incubation Center, and I would not forget to mention Mr. Akshay Patel, Manager Incubation Center. Special thanks to all attendees for participating in this talk series. Stay tuned. We will be definitely coming up with newer episodes again. Stay home, stay safe, and thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. This ends today's session. We'll keep continuing the similar episodes. Thank you. Thank you for joining.